summer, and we do pretty well. We started with just a pickup truck with some corn in the back. My cousin gave us the idea. She said, you can make $100 in a day if you do this, and you can stop by noon. Anyway, she was just running one stand. We figured out how to set up about 25 different stands and had a lot of fun doing it, but we sold corn, we sold watermelons, and we did okay. But here's the money shot I like. I wasn't a dealer, but we'd end up with all these, you know, you sell this green leafy stuff on the side of the road, you get a lot of cash. So we'd have to go make our deposit, and we'd just throw it in the gym bag. That's kind of my background. When I studied physics at BYU, I tried to figure out what to do, and I decided that some people I talked to, I thought being a patent attorney would be a good thing. So it's kind of a different route. I wouldn't say I necessarily fall within the an entrepreneur per se, but I interact with a lot of entrepreneurs now. So as Professor Little talked about, there's a lot of IP issues with new startup companies. And so you hear this word IP. What is IP? It's thrown around a lot. It's intellectual property, and what it is, it's creations of the mind or intellect that are protectable by law. And as I'm talking, I don't mean to just put people to sleep. And I don't have a lot of war stories. We can get into them if you want, but I thought what I'd do is just kind of talk about IP generally, and then hit the seven heavenly virtues. And
Sterling?
Yes?
So if it's okay, if there's something that he's talking about that you don't quite understand, would you please raise your hand and ask for a clarification? Because he'll talk about some definitions and things, and I think it's important that we all understand. And so is that okay?
During
the middle of your presentation?
Right. Yeah, if I don't get questions, I just present everybody surfing the web. So, yeah.
Do that to you.
Oh, yeah, of course not. If I keep it lively enough, they won't. To be honest, I realize, so this is something that I deal in all the time, right? So as I talk about it and talk through it, I've found in a lot of ways, it's kind of foreign if you don't do it a lot, right? So you hear it, your repetition, and my hope with this is as people are starting up companies or you're interacting with others, I don't expect, there's not going to be a quiz at the end, right? But what I'd prefer is...
Actually, there is.
Is there? Okay. Well, that's good. But I'll tell you what will cost you more is if you mess up one of these things. So so as we get done, I guess what I want you to think of is what we call in law school is issue spotting, right? When you're interacting with others or you're starting a company, you don't have to have the right answer, but you do need to be able to say, hold on, this is an issue. We need to think about this or talk to somebody, okay? So don't feel like you have to walk out of here with everything, but I just hope you know how to spot the issues when they arise, okay? So,
and don't worry, they won't have to, the quiz is pretty easy.
Okay.
But we will ask them a couple of questions about your presentation.
Okay, there you go. So you could fail a quiz or you could lose your trademark. either way, whatever motivates you. So generally, IP, it's broken down into four categories, and I'm listing these probably in the ones that are the most commonly encountered for startup companies. Trademarks, patents, copyrights, and trade secrets. Okay, so usually they'll fall within those four categories. Now, a good question is, what businesses have IP? Right? Maybe you're going to be one of those businesses that won't have IP, so you don't have to worry about it. The answer is all businesses have IP, whether they know it or not. If you're a business without IP, you're a business that's DOA. So, I'll give you an example. Who would have guessed? See, a lot of times people think of intellectual property, they think of like cutting-edge technology, right? Who would have guessed two dudes hauling corn in the back of a truck would have IP? Well, what do you see here? Right, one night we decided we need more stands, and we went and bought a whole bunk of plywood and put our sign, or put our name of our business on it, right? Does that fall within one of those four categories? Clearly, right, it's a trademark. So. The funny thing is we were trying to figure out what to name it, and it was probably about 1:30 in the morning. We had to wake up at like 3:30, and we get home picking up all the stands at around 11, 10:30, 11. Anyway, we were trying to make more signs and get better coverage of where we were selling our corn. And my brother said, what should we put on here? We had all these different, you know, fresh corn, good corn, get corn. And then I said, I don't know, dude, let's do call it darn fresh corn, right? And we did about one day of market analysis, and people liked it, right? So then we went all in, and we called it darn fresh corn. Was that a hand or a head scratch?
Head scratch.
Okay. Okay, I'm desperate here. No, I'm kidding.
Sterling, how fresh was your corn?
It was pretty darn fresh. Like I said, if you buy corn and it's not good, I'll tell you why. It's because that good corn will have, and this is a total tangent, but good corn will have more sugar in it than like ripe peaches.
Really?
Yeah. But that's why they make fructose and stuff out of it. Corn syrup. Anyway, it's good. So, but the trouble is all that sugar changes the starch if it doesn't stay chilled. So if you eat it right off the plant, it's really sweet. But if you get it shipped up from California, it's not so sweet. To answer your question, it was darn fresh corn, and it was darn sweet. And the other stuff they sold was like cattle feed. Okay, so a trademark, as you think through a trademark, it's a legal protection for a word or name or symbol. You know, if you go to like, anybody here like NASCAR? Okay. I love NASCAR, if anything, just because you have the trademarks everywhere. Everybody's advertising everything. They got the jackets, they got the cars. Nothing's more American than Trademark Central at a NASCAR race. But there's, you know, it's not just the name. There can be a sign. I mean, think through the companies you interact with. The Apple with the bite out of it. I mean, these are all trademarks. Here are some examples, some stylized characters. I love these. Logo sounds. If you think of like PBS or ABC, the ding, 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 that's trademarked. Smells, if you think of like perfumes and colognes, they can trademark, and even colors. So Caterpillar tried to get the trademark on their yellow color, and that would exclude other people from painting their equipment with the same color, and they weren't able to get that. But there are a lot of examples of getting a trademark for a certain class of goods on just that color. One example is, you ever seen your mom's ironing table and it's got that green cover on it? It's pretty typical and easy to recognize. That's a trademark color. So for that class of goods, it's their trademark. Now, if you think through what's the purpose of it, trademarks, they serve both sides of the transaction. So if you need a burger, you could go to, or I like the example of the Taco Bell, right? You go to Tijuana, and there's like four, it's been a while since I've been there. But you have like four different Taco Bells, right? Set up with the plywoods, you know, hand-painted sign. And they're all called Taco Bell. If you don't have your name on your goods, and it's your own name, you're less incentivized to maintain high standards, right? So the guy, like, I served my mission in Michigan. I remember there was guys that would sell catfish out of the back of their trunk, right? If you're buying catfish from some dude out of the back of his trunk, and you don't know if he's going to be there later, it might not be the highest quality catfish, right? But if you're going to the store and you're buying it, whoever sells catfish, name brand catfish, right? They're gonna try to maintain a certain quality or certain standards of quality. So it serves the consumers, and it also serves those that sell, right? Because they keep other people from palming off goods with their trademark on it. So it serves both people. It also reduces the transaction cost, or the searching cost for somebody that wants to buy a certain. Bush's beans, those are good beans, the no-name brand. Anybody, is no-name brand still a thing? I remember when I was a kid, that was what I ate a lot of. The black and white, it really had no name, right? But it was kind of joked about because it's like, who knows what's in there. But do you remember the no-name brand, black and white?
And now it's all stored around like Kirkland and stuff like that.
Right? Yeah, but I remember it was inconsistent.
Yeah.
Because it was no name. Okay. So that's trademark. Here's a couple examples. Coca-Cola, I just pulled these up. I thought this was interesting since we're at BYU. What are some other examples that you guys might have of trademarks? Well, the church is interested in their trademarks, the name of the church, right? You wouldn't want them, the church doesn't want somebody to put their name of the church on some, I don't know, the unsealed portion or something, right? I mean, you want them to stop from doing that, from palming off goods that doesn't have, that isn't the correctly identified with the source. The Leohona, these are just a few. The CTR, that's a logo. The friend. So I thought that was interesting. Okay. When do you get your rights in a trademark? And the answer is, is it's a legal protection for a word or name. The key is it's used in commerce to identify the source of goods or service. So just by beginning to use it, you acquire rights to it. If you don't use it, you lose it. That's how it works. Now, there's some advantages, we'll talk about this later, of registering a trademark. But when you start to use that, you develop a right to it. So for example, when I painted a darn fresh corn, and we're putting that all over, right? We never registered that. But we definitely wouldn't have, well, I think we would have acquired some rights in it. It was more than just descriptive. People, we started to identify it, and we had radio commercials. Yes?
Good question. So we talked a little about the church. And so they were going from LDS to Church of Jesus Christ at Work, especially on the website.
Right. Right.
So I was just wondering if you knew about that.
I don't know anything. Yeah, I don't. To be honest, I've always thought it's interesting. I presume that they purchased it. Just because you have a URL or a web address with it doesn't necessarily mean that it's yours either, right? If you remember, there used to be a lot of that, the cyber squatting, where people would do Walmart and all these different permutations of how you could misspell it. And then they, you know, just because a guy has that set up doesn't mean that it's necessarily his in all ways. One I like is, and I don't know if it's still the case, but Nissan.com. There was a fellow that's his last name. And I think he's still, I don't think Nissan.com is the automobile manufacturer. Anyway, somebody can, here, you guys are just web and surfing the web. Yes, sir.
At one point, if you have a small business, at what point do you need to register that trademark?
Whenever you think it might be valuable. Is it still him?
Yeah,
he's got an axe to grind with Nissan, too. that's a good question. So the reason why I listed trademark first is I can't imagine a business doing very well without a brand, right? And so that's usually the first thing to think about. People who think IP, they think patents. That's usually the first one. Trademarks are they're about a one-tenth, about an order of magnitude cheaper than patents. Every business should have one, and so that's a good one to look into quickly. Another thing that happens is, say for example, when we did Darn Fresh Corn, I didn't really search around. This is pre-internet days, right? So now that we have the internet, you can look around and see is your potential competitor already using that name, and you'd be surprised how many times people say, "Hey, I got this great name. We've been using it for a few weeks." You know, we got a website that's based on it, and then you look it up, and it's like, well, yeah, it's just really close to your competitor. That's not good, because in all your work that you've been putting in trying to build up the goodwill and name recognition on that, you're going to have to move. So it's about as interesting as a hole in your head. Yes, sir?
Yes, what about if I am trying to do a business in a country that has the same name, like I'm a company that a competitor has the same name as my company here in the U.S. Can I do anything to them?
Now, say that again. So you have a company that's outside of the U.S.
Yeah, I have a company in the U.S. and I want to, like, it has a name, and I want to work, and I want to do business in our country, and there's a company that has a name, and that's
not... Oh, that's outside the U.S.
Yeah.
So these intellectual property is an interesting thing, because it generally will. So there's ways you can move your brand outside the U.S. and have it protected, but all of these are going to be based on U.S. law. So just because you get a trademark in the U.S., it might be more problematic in some other country, and you have to work through those individual countries. So whether you can outside the U.S., without more details, I can't really speak on. But it's these are country-specific issues. There's ways to kind of streamline it to apply for, you know, similar rights in other countries, but they are different.
Yeah, to kind of go off, I served my mission in Australia, and they don't have Burger King there because someone already had a restaurant called Burger King, so they changed it to Hungry Jack's.
Oh.
So whenever you go to Australia, you just see Hungry Jack's and McDonald's, and you're like, what the heck is this place? But it's the same as Burger King, but they just couldn't call it Burger King.
Right. Yeah, that's interesting. And that happened, you know, if you think about commerce in the U.S., about 100 years ago is when these regional companies started to interface with each other. And so there were a lot of cases where a guy in California would have one business, and a guy in Alabama would have another business. They never knew about each other because they weren't selling a lot of interstate things, but then they kind of expand, and then they meet in Texas or wherever they meet, and then it becomes a big issue. And that's where you get these big trademark cases where they say, okay, well, who had it first? And a lot of times what they do is they just kind of regionalize it. Okay, you got to use it here, you have it here, and you really can't expand into each other's territory. So, that's a good question, and I think, it's like anything. It becomes an investment to you, so when do you want to start protecting it? When do you think it's valuable? But you can do a lot with searching beforehand, see what's out there. You can, and a lot of these things are, the federal government tries to make it easy for people starting up. So you can search through the database of the Patent and Trademark Office and see what's being used, what's registered, and that's notice to the public. So, okay. Any other questions? People love trademarks. I remember taking a trademark class, and it was always like a lively discussion. You start noticing it afterwards. Okay, I'll go on, and I think we have some Q&A time afterwards, right?
Yes.
So I don't feel obligated. We'll get through stuff. If we don't get through stuff, I don't feel... I like these slides, but I'm not that dedicated to it. Okay. Okay. The next one is a utility patent. Everybody probably just thinks of patents. There's a couple different kinds of patents. So the utility patents is another form of IP. And what it is, it's an exclusive right to make, use, or sell, or import an invention. And it's granted by the government to an inventor. Now, there's a phrase called quid pro quo. Has anybody heard that before? Quid pro quo? Okay, that's good. You guys probably aren't so. It came up with the President Trump and the impeachment thing, right? That's probably when it's become. You had a definition.
Yeah, you do something for someone in expectation of a return,
right? Right, right. So the patent system, it's interesting to think about, but the patent system is based on this quid pro quo, okay? Because it's a really strong right, if you think about it, to be the only one that gets to use your invention. Now, one thing to clarify, because I hear this a lot, you might come up with a process or some type of invention, but a patent isn't permission from the government for you to do what you invented, right? It's the right to exclude others from doing what you invented. And the quid pro quo is that if you explain it in a document that one of ordinary skill in the art could take and do, then they'll give you that right, as long as it's new and non-obvious and useful. We'll get to those. So if you think, if we didn't have a patent system and you invented a way to, say, like, produce gasoline, right? You might be incentivized to say, look, I'm just going to keep this to myself. I'm not going to tell anybody about it, and I'm just going to sell the gasoline, which some people decide to do. That works until the secret gets out, right? And we'll get to that later. Another way you can do it is you say, look, I'll disclose it to the government, and they'll make it public. Everybody will know my method, but I get to keep other people from doing it for 20 years. Okay? And so that's the trade-off. You got to disclose it. You can't keep a secret, but if you disclose it and you get the patent on it, then you get to exclude other people from doing it. Even if you don't do it yourself, you can still stop other people from doing it or importing it or selling it or whatever you want.
So when you say importing it, so if someone, say, how does that work with technologies that have more competitors?
Importing it. What do you mean?
So, like, for example, if there was technology that was made in the U.S., companies overseas found a way to make it cheaper, this, I guess.
Oh, okay. I think I know what you're saying. So, how about this? Does a U.S. patent protect you in China? Is that what you mean? So, can you enforce it outside the U.S.? They're limited to the jurisdiction that they're in. So, you can apply for patents in foreign countries. But your U.S. patent stops basically at the shoreline. But you can stop people from importing it in, right? So if you have a patent on these widgets, and the guy ships in a couple big containers full of infringing widgets, you can sue the guy, you can through the customs to stop it. But it does generally stop. So that is one thing that does happen. So say you have like I talked about, producing gasoline, right? And you make it public, yeah, there could be a guy in Argentina or Mexico that reads your patent, and he just starts doing it in Mexico. And unless you have a patent there, it'll be hard to stop him. But if he tries to bring it into the States, that's where you can stop him. OK? So, the background, I like this background kind of stuff. If you think about the foresight of the founding fathers, right, this goes back to the Constitution. One of the things that the Constitution gives the power to the Congress to do is to set up a patent and a copyright system, okay? So, I like this, the first patent examiner. So when you file, I always say when you file a patent, it's kind of like you don't file a patent. You hear that a lot. You file a patent application. It's like applying to college. You don't just go there. You file an application, and they let you know if you can, okay? It's kind of a similar process that gets examined at the patent office before they decide to give a patent. Sometimes you file an application, and you don't get a patent. But the three first examiners for the U.S. Patent Office was Thomas Jefferson, Henry Knox, and Edmund Randolph. They thought maybe in their spare time they could do a lot of this examination, but after a few years they decided that they were getting pretty backlogged and not a good idea for the Secretary of War to have him tied up with that. Anybody here been to the D.C. area and gone to Mount Vernon? Did you go to the grist mill? Do you know what a grist mill is?
I was a long time ago. I don't remember much of it. But.
Okay, how about the fellow in the black beanie? Did you raise your hand? Did you go to the grist mill?
I don't know if I did.
Okay, a grist mill is a big, it's where they grind the flour, right, or corn. Anyway, you can go there. George Washington was a huge farmer. He had like 10,000 acres in under agriculture. He also grew a lot of, or made a lot of whiskey. This was the third patent, and you can go to the grist mill they have there. They've like reset it up. And the fellow that came up with the system that would transport all the grain up, and then the flour, you know, how the whole thing worked, that he got a patent on. And George Washington put it on his farm. He saw the patent application. Guy got a patent and said, that is genius technology. One of the things they did is grinding the wheat or corn, the flour comes out hot and had this way to transport it up to the top and it put it in a circle and kind of turn it over slowly until it would meet the center of the circle and fall through the floor and it would cool down the flour. But George Washington saw that and thought, dang, that's going to be awesome. So he bought one of these grist mills or the equipment or the technology for it. So there's a long history of it. Let's do this. If you look through patents, now this is just a front sheet of a patent. There's a couple things now. Does this shoot? Oh. There we go. Okay. So there's a couple things. Has anybody seen a patent like this, or the front sheet of a patent? You seen one? I'll be careful not to hit you in the eyes. Okay, there's a couple things on it. It has the patent number, that's kind of important, that's how you identify it. The date of the patent, that's when it issues. So that's when the guy's right is enforceable. A lot of times you'll have when it's filed. So this is an old one, 1984, okay? Have the assignee on it. That's the person that they sold it to, or they're under an obligation to assign it to. And then the application number. This is prior art references that the U.S. examiner or the applicant submitted, and they decided this was different, it was new and non-obvious, over all these different references. A lot of times these references are going to be U.S. patents. Most technical literature, I think it was 85% of technical literature is patents. So when you talk about this quid pro quo, it's not just this academic idea. Most, you know, you think about like science, all these different journals you can go through. No, patents are where if you want publications on technology, it's a patent system that we're all sitting on due to the quid pro quo, okay? So this is just the front sheet. Let's go to the next one. Now, a lot of times they'll have drawings. We'll get to what this is. It's an interesting one. Anyway, they have some drawings describing it. Remember I said the quid pro quo, you got to describe it in a way that somebody could take it and do it. Then you'll have all this verbiage where they'll describe their drawings, right? And the idea is somebody should be able to take this and go, oh, yeah, oh, I see what they're doing. Okay, yeah. And they can go home and do it or do it in their shop, okay? Now, at the end, you have a claim. The name of the game, there's a judge, a real influential judge, he said the name of the game is a claim. Okay, the claim is kind of a concise, one-sentence description. Well, you can have different claims in your patent, but this is what you would infringe. If somebody were to infringe, they don't infringe your patent, they infringe the patent claim. Anybody know what this is? That wasn't here last year? No. Okay, did you know that, or did you remember it from before? Yeah, this is on the 3D printer, okay? And so it's a concise, this is the kind of sentence my English teacher in high school would have hacked up. But it's all one sentence listing out the features of the elements of what your invention is. Okay. So if somebody were to infringe this, what they would have to do is they would have to be doing, or their device would have to have, each one of these listed features. Okay. And if you're missing one of these features, if you say, well, we got A, B, but we don't have C, then you're not infringing. Or, alternatively, if we list like A, B, and C in your claim, it's no defense to say, yeah, but we have D, right? They don't care if you got D, right? You got A, B, and C. That doesn't matter. You could have D, you could paint it yellow. I don't care. You're infringing, okay? But it's kind of I joke with my wife at work. I feel like I come home playing Sudoku. I've been playing Sudoku for like 9 hours. So this is how a claim generally reads. And this is at the end of your patent, as you list what your claims are. And it usually starts out, I claim, okay? This is the most important part of the patent. The reason why I stress that, a lot of times I'll talk to people and they'll say, hey, this other guy's got this patent on such and such. And you look through the patent, it's got all these beautiful figures and stuff, and you're like, it could be relevant. And then you look at his claims, and it's like totally different or not close, or it has a lot of stuff, and you go, hey, look, this is kind of what he might disclose all this stuff, but he's claiming something that's different or maybe not so relevant as you think. Okay? Any questions? Okay, because I knew it was coming down to BYU, so I thought I'd look into this a little bit. Now, listen, I'm not doing this to suggest that this is the higher, holier way to do things, right? The church has a lot of patents. Well, they have some, okay? So, Intellectual Reserve, Inc., it's at the headquarters of the church. Anyway, it wasn't too surprising. There was some on like communications, a lot of headphones. I don't know how they got them. I don't do work for the church, but I thought it was interesting that they themselves have these different patents. So again, even the church has some IP outside of just their trademarks. Okay, let's see. Oh, this is a good one. So if somebody's doing, a lot of times somebody will do, hey, I looked around on Google Patents or whatever, and I found this patent. I'm really concerned about this patent, right? And this might be a patent, but what is this? Anybody know? I'll give you a hint. It's written on the top. Is this a patent? It's an application, right? This is like reading the guy's college application essays, right? And saying, this guy got into Harvard. Read his essay, right? And you say, well, yeah, let's look and see if he actually got admitted. So the tip-off is right there, right? It's a patent application publication. Now this might become a patent, and it's a publicly made. You can go to the USPTO's, United States Patent and Trademark Offices, and see what the status is of this. There's quite a few that go abandoned, right? This guy might have applied, churned, they turned him down. Finally, couldn't persuade him, and he said, "Okay, fine," and he walks away. The quid pro quo is, or the public benefit is, we got all this disclosure, right? And the government was able to show, look, it wasn't new or non-obvious, you don't get a patent, but thanks for the disclosure, right? And this guy's invention, it probably may be good, I don't know, but we have it now. Otherwise, we wouldn't have. So the tip-off is right there. It's just an application. And then the way the number is different. See that, how it's got a patent number right there? And this one is a publication number. That's different. See how it's done differently. Okay. I only mention this because I get asked this a lot, okay? So the next one, design patents, I'll go over this quickly, but if you think about, I like this with shoes, right? A company or anybody, a Dodge truck fan, right? Remember like in the late 90s when they came out with that grill of the Dodge pickup, the Dodge Ram that was just made you salivate? Does anybody remember that? Any other truck people around here? We got the one guy. Okay, well, it's a new generation. So if you think about a company, they spend a...
What about iPhone? There's one that we probably made.
Yeah, I was going to say, okay, you don't have to be truck people to appreciate designs. But if you think about companies, you know, they have these technology innovations, but say like your shoes, right? Nike spends a lot of time in coming up with a cool look for their shoes. And it's more aesthetic than it is functional, right? They do have the pump mechanism, and I'm dating myself. They got the pump thing. That's something that's functional. But a lot of times there's like an aesthetic design that they do. How do you protect that? You do that with a design patent. You file out of the patent office. There's some different rules to it. The terms of it are different. How it's examined is different. But they're quite a bit cheaper, and they're pretty, the enforcement is a little bit easier and less costly. The reason why is if you have to bring a jury, you know, if you have to have a jury, and they're looking at chromosomes and all these different steps that you're doing, right? Your average juror might get lost on it, right? But if you put before a jury this, right? Is this guy infringing? Or you guys might have seen this. Is he infringing? Well, there's my patent. There's my design patent. Here's what I think. Well, here's the allegedly infringing product, okay? A jury's going to say, it looks pretty darn similar, right? I mean, that's not the test. The pretty darn similar isn't the test they apply, but that's kind of what they end up doing. So these are called design patents. So in some ways, you might not be able to get it as you think through your technology or your invention. Utility patent might not be the best way to protect it, and a design patent might work pretty well, and the costs are might be a little bit more worth it. So something to keep in mind. I think that's all we have it. Copyright. Any other questions on patent theory? That's pretty common. They are different, and you can't protect. They serve different purposes, and so when it comes to the enforcement, you can't try to hoodwink the system by saying, "Well, I got a design patent, but it really is trying to cover this other aspect." Okay. Was there another question? So that's a good question. You can go file a patent application yourself. You don't have to have an attorney do it. Okay. But the trouble is it's more involved than like applying for a driver's license. Okay. I say that kind of tongue in cheek, but it's helpful to have somebody that's done it before, what to look for, and what you want to have at the end. So it could range from, you know, the guy that goes and does. I mean, there are guys that file applications themselves, and they see it to the end, okay? I'd say if you're going to go to a patent attorney and say, hey, I got this invention. Can you help me work out an application? I'm just giving you a ballpark numbers. To file it, to prepare, probably between $6,000 and $10,000. You know, five or six if it's kind of, I don't want to say simpler technology, but then, you know, if you think about like some of the big pharmaceutical companies, right, they've spent like hundreds of millions of dollars on these drugs, right? They're going to spend some money getting that application ready and getting as much coverage as they can on that. So the question, it's a good question. It's kind of like asking, like, what does a car cost, right? But you can. There's kind of ways to step into it. You don't have to pay all the costs up front, and also when you file the application, it might churn. You know, you might file the application, and the patent office says this is brilliant. Give that guy a patent. More often than not, they say, no, sorry, that's not patentable. And then you're in an argument with the patent office. It's a real formal proceeding because they want to make it public what the status is on this right that you're asking for. So there might be back and forth, and it takes years. You know, you write your application, they reject it with a real formal letter, and you have a certain time period to respond to that, and then they can respond to your response, and you back and forth. And it's hard to say how long that'll cost, but it usually takes, on average, about a year and a half to 3 years. And it can go through easily, and you can have to have somebody, or you can do it yourself. You can take a shot at, but, you know, just hours and hours and hours of basically, I like to think of it as negotiating, right? Because they want to say no, they got your disclosure, now they want to say, oh, sorry, this is not new, this is obvious. I joke how obvious everything is after you read my good description of it. So there's a little bit of negotiation, and even if it sails through, right, you could file your application with your claim, and you get a patent on it. That's like going and making an offer on a car, and the guy takes your first offer, right? It's great, he took your offer, but you might have left money on the table. And it's kind of the same way with your patent application. They might accept it and give you a patent right off, and then you wonder, well, maybe my claim should have been broader. Maybe my claim's narrow enough that my competitor will be able to come along and design around it and have some you know, have some features of my claim that he doesn't have in his product. So he'd say, well, I'm not infringing. This is a design around. Okay? Probably not a very satisfactory answer. Any other questions? Yes.
You reminded me of the thing you talked about, the truck grill, but I have just F-150 truck.
Right.
But the Raptor grill, like, has a Ford grill, and I bought one of those, but, like, when you buy it, it has, like, the new, like, grill, and you have to switch out the lighters. And I was just wondering, like, how do they enforce that? Because it seems pretty, like, Ford one should be able to do that. Because I just bought it, and you just switch the lighters out.
I'm not familiar with letters.
So they have the Raptor grill has this, and it says Ford on it, right?
Oh.
On the grill.
Right.
And, like, you can't buy that for, like, a different, like, type of truck or whatever.
Right.
But you can buy, like, this different grill on Amazon, and then it just has, you have to switch out two letters on the grill.
What does it change it to?
To Ford. But the other one says Ford.
Oh.
And then you switch.
I don't know. These are the specific questions without looking at the details. Just because you buy it on Amazon doesn't mean that it's.
I just don't wonder how they enforce that, because that seems borderline.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of stuff, and there's a lot of work that happens with it on online sales or Amazon sales or eBay sales. My boys buy Legos all the time from eBay. They come from China.
Oh,
I call them Figos. Okay. Copyright. We're just going to brush on IP, and then we'll be done. We're not even going to get to the seven heavenly virtues, I guess. Okay. It's fixed in a tangible medium. That's a key thing. If you want to copyright on something, it has to be fixed. So I thought this was interesting. Anybody know what this is? This is a Joseph Smith petition, or let's see, what do they call it at the time? Anyway, for the Book of Mormon's copyright. Okay, trade secrets. I like trade secrets. So what is a trade secret? It's information that's not known by others, that's protected by reasonable efforts, that gives you a competitive advantage over your competitors, or an advantage over your competitors. If you think about what it is, formulas, information, methods, designs, data algorithms, software, customer list, contacts. So say you have a guy that's doing your sales, he sells for you, and he keeps a whole list of all of his clients that he's selling to on your behalf, and then he leaves the company and he takes that with him. He might be walking out the door with some trade secrets. Or if you're a company that makes methanol, right, and you have this plant and you decide, I don't want to do a patent, what we'll do, you can't reverse engineer my methanol, so we'll just make the methanol at our plant and we'll never tell anybody. That's one way to protect it, right? The trouble with trade secrets is usually they're protected by contract, so if they go out the door, the saying is you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube, okay? So that's one way to protect it. Depending on the technology, it might be the best way to protect it, but isn't always the best way. So, for example, with my corn business, we had customer lists. It took years to work up these. One of the things we had, I had my buyers. I knew my good buyers where I'd keep this in a notebook. I had a whole list of people I had that would sell corn, right? It took years to find these guys that were good. If somebody walked out of my company or jacked this from my truck, I'd lose my competitive advantage in some regard. Okay, I'll just hit on a couple of these, and we don't have time to hit all seven. But these are some of the issues that come up when you think about IP in your startup company. The first one is ownership, okay? If somebody comes to you and he's gonna work with you on your new company and he's was formerly employed at another company that's your competitor, and he's got all sorts of great ideas, right? There might be an issue. Who owns those ideas that he worked up, right? He didn't come to you with a wiped mind, and so you want to be careful when you hire somebody or found something, a company with somebody, make sure he has a right to that, or she. I shouldn't just use he. Anyway, let's go through a couple of these. Another one that happens quite a bit is you say, hey, we're going to start a company, we're going to form it around an app. Let's get a software guy to help us write the app, right? And you go to the software guy and say, hey, I got this. And you start collaborating with him, and you know, he's got some good ideas, you got some good ideas, and you come up with something, and at the end of it, you go, hey, this is really inventive, and all of a sudden, you're killing it, right? Now the question is, Who owns that? Did you own it? Does he own it? Or she? Whoever helped you develop this, what was their role? Are they a founder? Are they an employee? Did you specify this beforehand? So if you're founding a new company, you want to be mindful of people coming in from the outside and giving advice or helping you develop something, because they might have a rightful claim, or they might have a legitimate claim to the rights of that IP that they developed. Now, how would you protect yourself from that? Okay, you could have a non-disclosure agreement, but you're going to disclose it, right? So one of the good ways to protect it against this is good employee contracts. So that's really common. Remember, I showed you on these assinees, hey, you're going to do work for me, and we're going to specify beforehand who owns that. And a lot of times, if you're an employee, it'll be assigned to the company that you work for. And right out of the gate, when he comes up with it, it should be assigned to the company. Okay. Let's wrap it up, and we can talk about virtues or sins.
And can we share your slides with the class?
Sure.
We'll post them on learning screen for everybody.
Great. Okay. There we go. There's a wrap. I got to one virtue.